Good evening and welcome to this Tuesday, October 25th, 2011 broadcast of the InfoWars Nightly News. I'm Aron Dykes sitting in. Alex is scheduled to return tomorrow. He has arrived, however, and he has a big TSA story to tell tomorrow on the radio show and here on this program. Now, coming up, we have a lot of vaccine news, as well as an update on the push for global government through the Occupy movement. But first, there's quite a bit of police state news to go over. Now, two of the biggest cities with gun bans are New York City and Chicago, and there's scandals going on in both of them. In New York City, cops were caught smuggling guns, even as the police chief, Ray Kelly, has been speaking out against illegal guns. They arrested eight NYPD officers and a Jersey correction officer for trafficking more than a million in illegal weapons, as well as other stolen goods. There's more details on that story, of course, but basically you've got disarmed citizens and police as part of the racket. Now, people like Zbigniew Brzezinski wrote about this in his book, Between Two Ages. I read the quotes last week, where as the system becomes more and more integrated globally, organized crime itself becomes part of the system that is meant to check crime. And you've heard people like Frank Serpico talking about how his unit in and around New York City was almost completely corrupt. Almost every officer was on the take. We're not saying that's the case today, but it certainly doesn't give good officers a good name. In Chicago, a cop is now under scrutiny for shooting a suspect three times in the back of the head after shooting what turned out to be a total of 16 shots. He ran from police after a domestic abuse complaint. And then this video that we're about to show shows an officer hitting him three times in the back of the head. Now, the suspect was Flint Farmer, and the officer was Geraldo Sierra. Sierra, well, there's the shots right now. You can see him in slow motion, and he was lying on the ground already. So if he was in custody, why would they shoot him in the back of the back three times? Why would they have to do that? Now, this officer, Sierra, shot two other people within a six-month period, one other case fatal. His case is now under investigation, but as the Chicago Tribune points out, there's not a very good track record over the past decades of Chicago police investigating itself, so we'll keep an eye on that situation. Now, on the other side of police state news, you don't just have corruption, but you have more and more a police state image being sold to the American people. Now, we wanted to show this Mazda ad before we get into some of the tracking technology to show how they're literally selling you on the idea of a car setting you free and increasing police state here in this prison ad right now.
Most 40-mile-per-gallon sedans are sentenced to a life of uninspired performance. Not this one. Meet the 2012 Mazda 3 with revolutionary SkyActiv technology. It's not the first 40-mile-per-gallon sedan.
And we're still looking at the specific research, but we have reason to believe that was actually filmed in a FEMA holding center, just like some of the ones we've investigated here in Taylor, Texas, and up in Hardin, Montana. But you really see the subconscious idea that America is becoming a prison, but somehow the car can still set you free. Now, we know that's not true. Right now, let's talk about some of the OnStar technology admissions that they're indeed tracking drivers, selling the data to police and other law enforcement, as well as to third parties. We share selected information with the following third parties, law enforcement or other public safety officials. Now, OnStar is, of course, not the only technology. Now, OnStar is, of course, not the only technology. There's all kinds of companies involved in all kinds of tracking schemes, some of them in vehicles, some of them in other areas. We know that TomTom, the popular GPS company, was caught selling data to police who then used that data to create speed traps, even though that's not quite as bad as other uses that could come up. TomTom had been unaware that Dutch police were using the data to choose locations for speed traps and that the company would prevent that type of usage in the future. So that's a report where they apologize after having to admit kind of a limited hangout. But other data is still being sold by similar companies. And we also know that the Progressive Insurance Company has been heavily, heavily marketing the savings you can get from their new Snapshot device. We reported on that back in January of this year. Now, this is a device you opt in to put into your car, and then it tracks your driving habits down to the speed and kind of your frequent areas. But they do tell us in this disclaimer that we will not share Snapshot data with any third parties unless it's necessary to appropriate your service from insurance policy, unless it's necessary to prevent fraud, unless we're performing research, or unless we're complying with the law. So performing research would, of course, include marketing research and plenty of other stuff. So there's part of the Big Brother system, part of the car, but you have freedom if you get a Mazda. And, well, I guess I'll let it speak for itself. At the same time, there's a new unmanned border checkpoint going on in Texas between Big Bend National Park and the accompanying city in Mexico, Boquillas del Carmen. A U.S. custom agent stationed miles away will remotely scan travelers' documents, allowing visitors to pass easily between Big Bend and the Mexican village of Boquillas del Carmen, which has fallen on hard times as beefed-up border security has cut down on U.S. visitors. Yeah, you bet it has. But, of course, drug cartels and illegal immigration will not be stopped. And also, will the internal checkpoints 50 or 100 miles in be stopped? I know there's one coming out of the Big Bend area. You saw a video last week and then the week before that of Alex Jones going through the internal checkpoints on the other end of Texas near the Mexico border and all the illegal activity going on there where they claim they weren't searching for drugs but only for narcotics and human odor. And, well, you see how that goes. It's all unconstitutional, and the idea of border security is just an illusion. Now, we're going to be going to break in just a moment, but first we want to talk about the money bomb. We've just aired a new promo video last night, and InfoWars really does count on your support. We're not corporate funded. We need people who want our mission to grow to help us buy and spread the DVDs and other t-shirts and bumper stickers to get the word out as well. We're on a mission here at InfoWars Nightly News. We're not just trying to bring you hard-hitting information and put a spotlight on the stuff the mainstream media won't touch or won't cover in the proper analysis. We're also trying to restore the republic and curb this global tyranny going on everywhere, seemingly without hesitation or halt at all. And to do that, we do need your support. Now, we do have you try to buy the DVDs, the t-shirts, the bumper stickers, which help get the word out as well. It's a dual mission. And we do have advertisers, but for the past 3 years, we've had a money bomb initiative to try to put us over the top. And Alex wants to use that platform to try to launch a new offensive to grow this program and other aspects of InfoWars and make sure we're reaching the people we need to. So we do ask for your support. That's coming up on November 3rd. And Alex is going to do another marathon broadcast, not just 24 hours, but 27 hours straight through from one radio broadcast to the next. We're going to have, it's going to be packed with all kinds of special guests, special video features, and a whole lot more. So please tune in for that. Spread the word about that broadcast and about InfoWars Nightly News in general. Coming up, we're going to have total vaccine coverage from the anthrax vaccine, proven to be dangerous, to the HPV vaccine, just approved for boys, and a whole lot more. We have exclusive video from Mike Adams, and we're going to cover the push for global government. But right now, we're going to go to break. Stay with us. InfoWars Nightly News, InfoWarsNews.com.
Ron Paul. A visionary who predicted the financial crisis. A leader with a plan to solve it. The Paul Plan? Balance the budget. Cut $1 trillion year one. Eliminate 5 federal bureaucracies. End the foreign wars and nation building. Rein in the Federal Reserve. Pay down the debt. Cut taxes to create jobs. Ron Paul. A plan to restore America now.
I'm Ron Paul, and I approve this message.
If you believe in this information and want to support its viral spread, go to the InfoWars store at InfoWars.com. We've got the new G.I. Joe InfoWars t-shirts. We've got the incredible Pro-Pure gravity-fed filters available at InfoWars.com in the store. We've got a new DVD, Sinus Under Attack, the Don't Tread on Me flag. We've got all sorts of different bumper stickers to help spread the rebellion virally. It's all there. Wristbands, citizen rule books in every order. Order online at InfoWars.com today. The water filters, the canteens, it's all there. InfoWars.com.
And welcome back from break. Again, I'm Aron Dykes sitting in, and Alex will return tomorrow. Coming up later in this long news segment, we have an interview with Mike Adams. But first, we just wanted to highlight some of the Occupy protest footage in Sydney, Australia, where police became violent while removing protesters. Now, there is no hard, fast rule for free speech in Australia. However, political speech is supposed to be protected. It's a very glorified so-called right, as long as it's not hate speech, blah, blah, blah. Nonetheless, why did police go to these measures? Let's cue the video.
From the critical incident response unit, the riot squad, people from uniform, even people with search and rescue gear on. Police are dragging these protesters out. As you can see, they're being held by their arms, their legs. We have been tweeting about this, we've been updating our website, but now things have just taken an absolute turn.
Now, it's hard to believe these police are going to get it by the time the bankers come for their pensions and so forth. These Occupy Sydney protesters have vowed to come back in force in 3 days from the time of that video. I think that's on the 26th, which is tomorrow. We'll see what happens there. But in other parts of the Occupy movement, I just wanted to use my platform to try to issue a warning. We know the Occupy movement's broad. We know the anger's justified. We know there's every reason to call out the bankers, the corruption, the cronyism, the government access, and the rest of it. However, there is an increasing movement to bring about a global solution for this global economic crisis, and I'm not going to stay silent about it. Patrick Henningsen wrote about it tonight. Robinhood tax, Occupy movement now marching straight into the globalist trap. There it is. And he warns that Adbusters, the very group that helped form the very first Occupy movement protest, has called for a global taxation system under a new global government body, basically for a Robin Hood tax, better known as a Tobin tax, that would tax shares, bonds, derivatives, but also pensions. Now, we know a Tobin tax could be useful if the laws were written right, if it was put forward within sovereign nations, but a global body very dangerous. The only reason to do that would be to rein in derivatives. But this is not the only call for global government. There was also last week Kurt Nemo's article on the call for global governance from people like Noam Chomsky and others who want global democracy. And they wrote a manifesto calling for the way they'd like to go about that. That's tied in with the United Nations Parliamentary Association. They say instead of calling for abolishing global networks like the IMF, WTO, multinational banks, the G20, European Central Bank, and the UN Security Council, the manifesto calls for simply democratizing them. And they're going to take these and similar demands to the G20 protest coming up in a short time period from now. We have some of the video here from the creepy call for one world global democracy.
United for global democracy.
United for global democracy.
October 15, 2011. United in our diversity.
United in our diversity.
United for global change.
United for global change.
We demand global democracy.
We demand global democracy.
Global governance by the people, for the people.
Global governance by the people, for the people.
Inspired by our sisters and brothers in Tunisia.
Inspired by our sisters.
The problem is that global governance by the people for the people is a dangerous trap and illusion. Global government was pushed for and is run by the very corporate interests that these people are supposedly protesting against. Now, people really need to wake up and do some research and find out who the big banks really are and what kinds of social agendas they put all their money into. Rockefeller Foundation, a very good place to start. Also funding some of the groups you think are part of your movement. It's very dangerous. But global democracy is not the only form. There's also world federalism. One of the members was this guy, Cord Meyer, the CIA black ops commander, who was also a president of that organization. You also know people like Hillary Clinton and Walter Cronkite. There's a creepy speech where Hillary thanks Walter Cronkite for calling for global government. I want to play an example now of somebody at Occupy Vancouver who calls for world federalism and quotes George Soros and how great his platform is for global democracy. Do we have that
money
video?
And how is new money created?
Yes.
I'll pass on that. That's too deep for me right now.
Okay. So, why are you here?
I'm here because of the movement that it's been coming a long time, but it suddenly clicked. I'm believing they occupy the planet for the brotherhood and sisterhood of humankind. And wanting to broaden it out to just the banking thing. That's just part of the problem.
Okay, and what group are you with?
I'm with a group, well, this notice is about the World Federalists, which believes that we must move beyond the United Nations towards a world federation. This is why I'm saying the brotherhood and sisterhood of humankind. Human sovereignty must supersede national sovereignty. George Soros said that, not me, the billionaire. He made that.
The banker.
The banker, yeah. He also wrote the article in the Atlantic Monthly about the capitalist threat.
So George Soros will lead us to global brotherhood, and it's all for your own good, a system beyond the United Nations, which is just, at best, a shoddy illusion. All very scary. Obviously, those kinds of people don't represent the movement as a whole, but those people with that agenda seek to sweep everyone into these global solutions, and that's why it's so dangerous. The Vatican has joined in the call for a global central bank on the heels of the EU President Herman Van Rompuy calling for a single treasury to oversee the spending and taxation in the European Union. Now, the Vatican wants a global public authority. Is this starting to sound familiar? Now, the Vatican released an 18-page document entitled Towards Reforming the International Financial and Monetary Systems in the Context of a Global Public Authority. And the Vatican's Justice and Peace Department commented that, quote, this should be music to the ears of the Occupy Wall Street demonstrators and similar movements around the world who protested against the economic downturn. That quote was in CNBC. Another Reuters quote says, this should please the Occupy Wall Street demonstrators. You can see where that's a talking point. Reuters, however, has edited this article and updated it. Occupy Wall Street protesters this month sparked similar anti-capitalist movements around the world. So they're trying to draw in this anger and sentiment, righteous as it may be, from the Occupy movement into a global solution. That's what's dangerous here. Not that the Vatican in particular will have their document come to fruition, or the world federalists who openly call for world global taxation system, not that their solution in particular will be adopted or any one solution, but that they're moving in that direction, trying to sell the public. That is why I am warning you here today. Now, in other news, there's all kinds of vaccine stuff going on, not the least of which is a new push for the anthrax vaccine, which they say they want to test on children. Headline here, Obama wants to test anthrax vaccine on kids. And the Washington Post says it's hard to believe that it's something that makes a great deal of sense, said Joel Frater, a pediatrician and bioethicist at Northern University's Feinberg School of Medicine. It would be difficult to justify testing it on kids simply on the hypothetical possibility that there might be an attack, an anthrax attack, which after 9/11 admittedly came from within the military. They tried to blame a patsy, but clearly the government is the only one who could release such an attack credibly. A spokesperson for the vaccine says if there was an anthrax release and we needed to administer anthrax vaccine, we have no experience with kids. It's never been in the arm of a kid. And this person, Lurie, stated, I started asking myself, is this the right way to respond in an emergency? So clearly they want to create emergency conditions so they can vaccinate more. At least that's my take on it, my opinion. And we now have a Fox News clip, if we could go to that now.
6 million in the military,
and many of them
have been tested and administered this vaccination.
And about 1 out of 200,000 serious effects, either neurological or autoimmune, immune system problems. So it's not without, like any vaccine, has complications.
Yeah.
If it did come, you could give antibiotics. If you treat the people with antibiotics right away, they get better.
Is that Cipro?
Cipro or a tetracycline. You have two types of antibiotics. What we should be working on is how do we get it to the people fast enough should there be an attack?
Have we-
So there's a lot going on in that clip. You could see it for yourself. But he does point out there are dangers to the anthrax vaccine, though he kind of implies they're very low, something around 1 in 200,000. Now, there's a government GAO, that's the Government Accountability Office report from back in 2002 about the anthrax vaccine and its effects on military personnel who were given that vaccine. According to our survey, 37% of Guard and Reserve personnel who received one or more anthrax vaccine shots, of those, 84% reported side effects or adverse effects. 84%, a rate more than double of what was expected or cited in the product insert for the anthrax vaccine. Further, the GAO found that on the basis of our survey, each anthrax shot generated more than 4 reported events, and each respondent received close to 4 shots of anthrax vaccine. Thus, the average respondent had reported experiencing about 17 reactions or events thought to be attributable to the anthrax vaccine. That was in 2002, but everything's okay now because they say they now have a vaccine for anthrax combined with smallpox, and so that'll be good for you, I'm sure. Reuters reports how researchers have combined vaccines against smallpox and anthrax into one tidy vaccine that could protect against both germs in a biological attack. And you've seen the other crazy reports where they have new vaccine guns that they think will put 17 or more vaccines into one blast that'll go right into your genes. And we've talked to some of the experts. They say it's because people won't come in for the vaccines, so they want to get them with everything they got when they got them. Just abhorrent. Now, there's other vaccine news, and that is over the new GlaxoSmithKline malaria vaccine. And, of course, the mainstream media says the results are very promising, and they cite the promising from a trial conducted by the vaccine developer, as well as some of our other friends in the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and the PATH Malaria Vaccine Initiative. And you've seen the clips where Bill Gates admits that they have to bring down the population and essentially ties it in with vaccination among other reasons to bring down the carbon dioxide levels of the world. And he's over there bringing sympathy for vaccination in Africa, telling us how he's going to save the world. But what is the truth? Let's look at the reports. Mike Adams talks about how the media pushes the success of the experimental GSK, GlaxoSmithKline malaria vaccine, while ignoring the deadly side effects. That report's up on Natural News, but we have video now of Mike Adams talking about this new vaccine.
Here we have the Washington Post reporting that the anthrax vaccine's effectiveness in children stirs a debate. The White House is trying to decide whether they should inject children with this anthrax vaccine to determine if it works. And they think, well, this is a bioethics question. So they have a group of bioethicists, a bunch of advisors, we're trying to argue, yeah, we should use children as guinea pigs now because we might be able to save children in the future. If there is an anthrax attack in America, then we'll have a vaccine ready to inject into them. But the cost of doing that today is that we're going to have to probably sacrifice a few children today because, you know, the governments of the world, the big controllers are always into child sacrifice. That goes back throughout history. They know some children might die, some children might have permanent damage, neurological side effects, who knows what, but they are arguing that that's going to be worth it. Well, I say that's nonsense. That's complete nonsense. First of all, the children aren't going to encounter anthrax just at the playground at school. There would have to be a bioterrorism attack in order to expose children to anthrax. And secondly, what's this idea? Who's going to make the money from this anyway? Of course, the pharmaceutical industries. So this is just another example of trying to use innocent children, the bodies of American children, to make more money for the pharmaceutical industry. And they're trying to justify it by saying, oh, this is ethical. We could save more lives in the future by sacrificing a few now. Isn't that what every tyrant throughout history has always said? Isn't that the entire eugenics movement in a nutshell? Yeah, we can save the human race by sacrificing a few people today, making them infertile or just outright killing them, and then the human race will be better. That's what they say. Yeah, that's what the whole eugenicist movement is all about. But my question about this is, how do you know if the vaccine really worked? Suppose they inject these children with this anthrax vaccine, this experimental vaccine, the same one they injected into the soldiers in the Gulf War, many of which are suffering serious neurological side effects, you know, Gulf War syndrome. And that's a big deal. That's real. You can't call all these soldiers liars. They are really experiencing these symptoms. But how do you know if this even works? Are they going to take the children, inject them with the vaccines, and then expose them to anthrax and find out how many live and how many die? I mean, or how would you know if it's even effective? But I have another theory. I think the measure of effectiveness is not how many lives it saves. I think the real measure of effectiveness is how many children it injures so that they can become future customers of the pharmaceutical industry. You see, this is the main point of vaccines today. It's not really to protect you from the flu. You can protect yourself from the flu with vitamin D. You can protect yourself with good nutrition, with sunlight, with basic immune-boosting strategies that are very easy, very safe, very effective. The point of vaccines is to make you a victim. It is to trap you in the medical system so that you have kidney problems, so that you have liver disorders, so that you have a neurological problem that requires more treatment, or cancers that require more treatment down the road. That treatment pays big bucks. The drug industry knows that the more kids they can get vaccinated today, the more money they're going to make from those children when they grow up and become adults seeking health care, so-called health care. So, and we know this is true. The Institute of Medicine, even in its report, and by the way, it is a pro-vaccine organization, it admitted that the MMR vaccines contain live measles viruses, okay? It admitted that those vaccines cause measles in some children. It admitted that there are side effects. And again, this is an organization that usually covers for the vaccine industry. But now, to make things even crazier, check this out. Where is this? The media is pushing the success of the experimental GlaxoSmithKline malaria vaccine, but they're ignoring the deadly side effects. You see, yeah, they're saying this malaria vaccine is a big success now. It's all a spin story. It's all a hoax. It's not really a success because you've got the side effects. You see, yeah, okay, if the vaccine is effective, it might reduce malaria by some percentage, but what about the increase in the percentage of those people suffering neurological side effects? What about the kidney failure? What about the cancers? What about the adjuvants that are used in these vaccines that cause brain damage, that cause inflammation of the brain? What about the increases in the cases of Alzheimer's down the road? So you prevent maybe 5% of the malaria cases today, and then you have a 40% increase in Alzheimer's and cancer and diabetes. They call that a success. Of course it's a success to the pharmaceutical industry because, again, they make money off the long term when you stay sick. And vaccines are designed to keep you sick.
And there is Mike Adams talking about the general dangers of vaccines, including in regard to the new malaria vaccine and the anthrax vaccine we talked about before. Now, the same BBC report that tells you that the malaria vaccine has very promising results also points out that many of the side effects include meningitis and seizures. And they are conducting those trials in Africa where people are perhaps not as on guard. And in fact, here's another statistic. In 2006, polio was reported on the rise in Nigeria despite an almost universal rate of vaccination in that country. Where do you think that polio came from? Do your own research. Now, the BBC also reported that malaria deaths have fallen 20% worldwide in the last decade. So even though the deaths are on the decline, mad scientists like Bill Gates, mad billionaires with scientists in their pocket, rather, like Bill Gates, continue to push all kinds of crazy so-called solutions, including genetically modified mosquitoes to fight malaria, all unlimited money for these trials for malaria vaccines, and a whole lot more. The same Bill Gates who, with the Rockefeller Foundation, pushes genetically modified crops on Africa, forces them to take it, and has a whole body and initiative set up to push them. Now, in other vaccine news, they are now pushing the extremely controversial HPV vaccine, which Rick Perry, the presidential candidate, mandated in Texas under a hoax. Now it is being recommended for boys. We have a clip here where they're discussing trying to approve it for trial. And an article, CDC committee recommends boys receive HPV vaccine. Alex Jones told you years ago they were going to push this on boys. Part of the new push is now because girls aren't getting vaccinated in the numbers doctors expected because the dangers have come out. And they say if boys are also immunized, it reduces the transmission back and forth, said Dr. Schaffner. Even though they don't get cervical cancer, not only are these expensive shots that enrich the pharmaceutical industry, they're very dangerous. We've had on experts to talk about the adverse reactions and how high they are compared with the number of cervical cancer deaths each year, which this vaccine does not even protect against. And even those adverse reactions are highly underreported. We have a clip here, I believe.
Whenever one of these vaccines comes out, especially when it's just for kids, is it going to make my child sick? Is it safe?
Right. And you will see controversy politically on this. You will see controversy among some online communities. There's really no controversy among doctors. In the medical world, they say this is a safe vaccine. We've given it to millions of people around the world. We have not seen serious consequences.
Great. Okay. Thanks so much, Elizabeth.
No serious consequences, even though you've seen on this program and in other places the just heartbreaking testimony from girls whose lives it has changed forever. They've been paralyzed. They've had brain disorders. They've had reduced IQ and brain functioning. There's also been many deaths. So don't tell me there's no bad side effects. Now, we have a clip here of the CDC approving their recommendation for boys. A panel voted. So now it's going to be pushed on boys, even though doctors say it's going to be a hard sell because everyone knows how dangerous and controversial this vaccine is. Let's go to that clip.
It would help the boys. It would help prevent genital warts for boys. It would help prevent certain types of cancer for boys. And it would also help keep boys from giving HPV to girls, because that's how girls get it, is they get it through sexual contact with boys. So this committee at the CDC, they're going to be looking at this today, and they're going to be reviewing whether or not boys should be getting the HPV shot. That's Gardasil, the one that girls now currently are supposed to get.
So in fact, the CDC panel has now voted to recommend this vaccine for boys. And the same CDC that knows what's best for our children, supposedly, has had a very controversial arrest. Kimberly Quinlan Lindsay, who is an executive for the CDC, has been arrested for child molestation involving a six-year-old boy and for bestiality charges. She's now out of jail on a $20,000 bond. There's more details in that story, I'm sure. Lindsay, 44, serves as the deputy director for the Laboratory Science Policy and Practice Program Office at the CDC, according to her biography on the agency's website. And she's a graduate of Emory University, and there's more on the website. But that just shows you what kind of people run the system that tries to run a hoax and tell you vaccines are required, even though they've been dangerous, and they're part of the larger eugenics program as well. Just look into it for yourself. Find out who funds all this activity, from global government push to eugenics to vaccines and a whole lot more. Again, I mean, if you don't know where to start, the Rockefeller Foundation's a good place. Alex Jones will be back tomorrow with a lot of hard-hitting news and his stories about encountering the TSA in Las Vegas. That's all for tonight on the InfoWars Nightly News. Please support us November 3rd on the InfoWars Money Bomb, or just help us spread the word as you can and spread the word about this program. Good night.